Hello, Ace. This is RetroTK2, and today you'll learn all about properties in C#. We'll take a look at MSDN's definition of a property. Then we'll look at some of the more primitive ways of accessing a private field. After that, we'll declare our very own property. And finally, we'll access that property. If this is the first C# video you're seeing, I'd strongly advise watching the series from the start. Card should be on your screen now. And if you haven't already, might I suggest downloading the channel files that accompany this video. The card should be on your screen once again. So let's get started. Well, what is a property? According to MSDN, properties are members that provide a flexible mechanism to read, write, or compute the values of private fields. Properties can be used as though they are public data members, but they are actually special methods called accessors. This enables data to be accessed easily while still providing the safety and flexibility of methods. Let's take a closer look at these things in action. Open up Unity and create a basic C# script. As always, make sure to give your script a different name than any other class in your project. Here I'm going to create a very basic class. Nothing too special here is, so feel free to call it whatever you like. In the last C# video, the card is on your screen now in case you missed that, Ace, we looked at fields in C#. Here I'm defining a private int field called myInt. Now, a property is very similar to just defining a get and set method in your class to access the myInt field. So for example, I can define a public method called getMyInt with return type int and simply return myInt from it. Likewise, I can define a public method called setMyInt with a void return type that takes an int parameter and sets myInt to that parameter's value. Okay, let's access our getter and setter methods in the tutorial 14 class's start method. Create a new object from the class we just created and invoke both the get and set methods. Now hey, you may be thinking to yourself that's completely pointless and the same thing could be achieved by just making the myInt field public and using it like so. Well, yeah, that's somewhat true, yes, but the real power of getter and setter methods is when you get the chance to perform other actions when the data is accessed. For example, if I wanted to find out how many times myInt's getter method was accessed, I could add a counter to the getMyInt method and increment it each time it's accessed. Similarly, I could add some validation logic to the setMyInt method to limit the value of myInt to be between 1 and 4. I could also add a debug log to get the full stack of where the getMyInt method was called from. A little bit out of the scope of this video is, so I'll move on swiftly. One slight disadvantage of this is that it's not always clear what actions are going to be carried out when you try to access the data. So say I call the getMyInt method in my code, I really only expect to get myInt's value. I'm not expecting a counter to be incremented, and I'm certainly not expecting a log to occur. You may want to bear that in mind when you're using them in your code, since it can get a little bit confusing. You can also remove your getter and setter method altogether in order to limit the access to the myInt field outside your class. So say you only ever wanted people to read the value of myInt and not be allowed to set that data, you could remove the setMyInt method and deny them the ability to change the value outside your class. Anyway, the wonderful coders at Microsoft felt that having to declare your getter and setter methods like this was a bit unnecessary. So they decided to create properties instead. Let's create a property called myInt. Declaring a property is very similar to creating a field. We start by giving the property an access modifier, public in this case. Then we give the property a type, which is going to be an int. And after that, we declare the property's name, which is myInt. All stuff that we've seen before is nothing too different yet. But now we're going to mix things up a bit. Open your curly braces. Oh yeah, we're going off the rails now, yes. Type in the get keyword. What is the get keyword? Well, according to the Microsoft docs, the get keyword defines an accessor method in a property or indexer that returns the property value or the indexer element. After the get keyword, open your curly braces once again, yes. This is basically our getMyInt method we defined earlier, and it expects us to return an int. Here I'm going to return the myInt field. Now to declare a set method, I type out the set keyword. What is the set keyword? Well, according to the Microsoft docs, the set keyword defines an accessor method in a property or indexer that assigns a value to the property or the indexer element. I'm sure you never guessed that, Ace. Open your curly braces straight after it. Here I'm going to set myInt to the value passed to the set accessor. But wait a second, Ace, there's no parameters being passed here. Ah, you have to use the value keyword. What is the value keyword? Well, according to the Microsoft docs, the contextual keyword value is used in the set accessor in ordinary property declarations. It is similar to an input parameter on a method. The word value references the value the client code is attempting to assign to the property. So value here takes the place of myInt parameter from the setMyInt method. Right, let's access our Git and set accessors in the tutorial 14 classes start method. If I type out my class and hit full stop, you'll see that our myInt property can be accessed. Which accessor is used depends on the way the property is accessed. So if I logged out the myInt property, the get accessor will be called. If I try to assign 10 to the myInt property, the set method is used. So it works pretty much the way you would expect it to, yes. The order of the get and set accessors doesn't matter, so by all means, put the set above the get if you like. You can also add access modifiers to the get and set methods should you feel the need to limit their scope to just this class. But be warned, Ace, you can't make them both private. You could also just not declare them if you like, though doing so may cause a compiler error if you attempt to access the respective accessor. Now, creating a property like this is great and all, but having to create a private field and also having to declare the getSet methods for the property is a real pain. Well, yes, there is an easier way to do it. Here I'm creating a new property called myString that is of type bool. Nah, just kidding, yes, it's a string. This time I open up my curly braces and type the get keyword just like before. Except instead of opening my curly braces, this time I type out a semicolon. You'll get an error, but if you do the same thing with the set keyword, all should be fine. This is an auto-implemented property, Ace. What is an auto-implemented property? Well, according to the Microsoft docs, in C# 3 or later, Unity uses C# 4, Ace. Auto-implemented properties make property declaration more concise when no additional logic is required in the property accessors. They also enable client code to create objects. When you declare a property as shown in the following example, the compiler creates a private, anonymous backing field that can only be accessed through the properties get and set accessors. Auto properties can also be prefixed with the private access modifiers, Ace, but you can't remove the set or get keywords. Both are required for the auto property, I'm afraid. This has been a look at properties in C#. And that's it. Rate, comment, and subscribe, Ace. I hope you're enjoying series 2. You can email me at retrotk2@gmail.com with the good news of the day. Thank you for watching this, and I'll see you in the next video.